Hi guys, today I'm going to continue discussing the ancient Rose City of Petra with its spectacular and massive rock-hewn caves carved into red sandstone. These caves are said to have been carved about 2,000 years ago. The most iconic of them all is the Treasury, which is located at the final twist of the towering walls of the Sick Canyon. This stunning structure is almost 40 meters or 130 feet high and intricately decorated with Corinthian-styled capitals, friezes, figures, and reliefs. Looking at its magnificent exterior, one cannot help but wonder how this incredible facade was created 2 millennia ago. Fortunately, I located some great close-up photos of the treasury's exterior, which are very telling. From these photos, we are able to get an idea what went into the creation of the facade. We can see clues showing that the structure was possibly reworked on and repurposed in a later period, which might challenge the current narrative and put acclaimed creators of Petra into question. Let's get started. Archaeologists suggest that the Raqqa city of Petra was created by the Nabataeans as early as 4th century BC. In my last video, I explained why I disagree with this statement by comparing Petra with other major Nabataean cities. Almost all surviving Nabataean cities look nothing like the signature Petra style. The only ancient city that shares a resemblance with Petra is Hagra in Saudi Arabia, but it still contains significant differences in the rock carving scale, quality, and purpose. I believe the real creators of Petra predate the Nabataeans by a long period of time. It's likely that the Nabataeans discovered Petra and adopted the place as their own. If you want to check out that video, the link is at the upper right corner. The sizes of Petra caves are astonishing. One cannot fully appreciate their scale until you see the structures photographed with people as reference points. How were caves this massive, excavated and created with accurate facades, sharp edges, and 90-degree corners 2,000 years ago? In order to study the potential construction method, we need to search for details. One of the most revealing clues is the tool marks at the urn tomb. These ancient tool marks are like fingerprints in our forensic investigation. The urn tomb has a cavernous chamber over 3,400 cubic meters, or 120,000 cubic feet. Whoever created this cave on a high cliff made the incredible effort to excavate out a humongous amount of stone that can almost fill 2 Olympic swimming pools. An equally striking feature of the urn tomb is the fine markings that cover the entire walls and ceilings. These highly uniformed, parallel markings are impossible for hand tools to achieve and clearly resemble machine marks. If Petra monuments are really 2,000 years old, per mainstream academia, that means the urn tomb was excavated with traditional hand tools like chisels and hammers. Is this assumption by archaeologists reasonable or practical? Here I'm showing a clip of today's stonemason using chisel and hammer to work on sandstone. It's obvious that even with a relatively finished surface, it's still difficult for a mason to carve long, continuous, parallel markings within close proximity. We also need to keep in mind that the sandstone in Petra is hard with high quartz content. These cave facades might look melted and soft due to long-term erosion, but the stone is close to a 7 on the Mohs scale, which means it's almost as hard as granite or steel. Carving such hard stone in this tremendous scale would have been a daunting task, not to mention creating these unbelievably uniformed marks in the urn tomb. It's unnecessary and impractical to dress the gigantic cave with these tightly aligned markings with chisels. Then what tools are able to excavate a hard sandstone and leave such marks? The uniformity and consistency of the markings remind me of today's continuous mining machines, which can create similar parallel markings. But the urn tomb is ancient. There were supposed to be no advanced machines 2,000 years ago. Then how did the cave get excavated in the first place? Was the urn tomb unique? Can we find these markings at other impressive caves in Petra? Let's go to the most famous structure of Petra, the Treasury. According to archaeologists, this colossal monument represents the Hellenistic style and was most likely constructed in the 1st century BC or the beginning of the 1st century AD. We can see the natural stone veins extended from columns to walls, which indicate that the elaborate façade was carved from stone instead of being cast. Here are some great detailed photos I found on the Treasury. The flat surfaces on the columns look smooth from afar, but they are not. If we zoom into these surfaces, we can see that there are countless delicate parallel markings on the entablatures. Even the curved surfaces are finished with exceptional markings. On top of that, we can see the same fine excavation marks on the round columns. This is incredible. These markings, even though at some areas are changing directions, in general appear to be highly uniformed and parallel with consistent spacing. Have you ever seen such fine carved markings in a similar scale anywhere else, especially on curved surfaces? Carving short, smooth, parallel, and straight lines on flat surfaces is already hard enough. How did the ancient masons carve these accurate and amazingly aligned markings with the same curvature? Please don't forget that the bottom columns are about 15 meters or close to 50 feet high, which means the masons would need to be working high above ground to carve these continuous parallel marks on round columns. It almost looks like the work from today's 3D stone carving robot, which can also make clean-cut, precise lines. 3D carving robots can create sculptures with accurate details by using digital modeling, 3D scanning, 3D printing, and robotic carving. But we're talking about the ancient city of Petra, which is at least a few thousands of years old. There shouldn't have been such advanced tools available. Moreover, other parts of the treasury show markings that are very much the same as the ones we see inside the urn tomb. These photos were taken close to the entrance of the treasury. Please be mindful that these walls have been damaged with graffiti. Portions of the facade have been restored, painted, and/or refinished multiple times throughout history. Still, we can find some areas have these distinct, finely aligned markings. I think this could be the original stonework. I also found similar markings at some other Petra caves, such as the tomb of Sextus Florentinus. Petra stonework is truly astounding. As mentioned earlier, dressing stone with smooth, tightly placed, and parallel marks is not easy for masons to do with chisels. Imagine the insane workload needed to cover the entire exterior of the treasury with these fine tool marks. Could this be accomplished with hand tools? I highly doubt it. It will be extremely difficult or impossible to carve these surfaces with hand chisels, especially at this high level of consistency. In addition, was it really necessary to carve these parallel markings on the facades to achieve flat or curved surfaces? In Hagra, the real Nabatean rock cut tombs also have flat surfaces, but were achieved by masons carefully chipping away extra stone and leaving small tool marks. These irregular tool marks came from hand tools used in ancient times. While in Petra, the urn tomb and the treasury are carved with exceptionally accurate markings, which present a much more sophisticated, machine-like technique. Now, I want to point out something else I noticed on the detailed photos of the treasury's facade. Not all areas are created with the uniformed markings. It's interesting to see that the most elaborate column capitals and the decorative elements on the frieze present a different kind of mark, which is consistent with chisel marks. From these photos, I think it's fair to say that the parts contain ornamental reliefs showing inferior finishing stonework. These different types of tool marks were probably done by different teams of masons, with dissimilar tools separated by time. If all the work was done by the same crew, the finishing quality should have been consistent. The typical sequence of stone carving would be first to remove large quantities of stone and rough out the basic form, then to create clear surfaces and give definition to the form, followed by adding details. The detail carving comes last. Since we see chisel marks on the column capitals and other ornate patterns, which means these were likely done after the visibly superior parallel markings on the main forms. So again, we see the earlier work quality is more sophisticated than the later ones. Why is that? The stonework on the treasury's column capitals resemble the ones on ancient Greek and Roman structures. These two cultures are well known for their monumental buildings with beautiful details. But unlike the fine markings we see at Petra, the Greeks and Romans preferred a smooth look and left almost no tool marks on flat surfaces or columns. The smooth stone blocks used in these constructions were presumably cut by stone saws, and the columns carved on site with chisel marks buffed out. So the distinct markings at Petra do not belong to the ancient Greek or Roman masonry customs. Did the Greeks and Romans remove their fine tool marks as the final finishing process, and that's why we don't see them today? I think not. Here are photos of some unfinished stoneworks at ancient Greek and Roman sites. We can see that point or tooth chisels were used to create forms and surfaces. These hand tools left typical chisel marks, which are not continuously parallel. In another close-up photo, we can see the irregular tooth chisel marks. If the stone surfaces would be scraped or buffed smooth at the end, then why bother painstakingly carving highly uniform markings anyway? It doesn't add up. Therefore, the ancient Greek and Roman masonry techniques are different from the machine-like markings at Petra. Let's not forget that the treasury is said to be created imitating the Hellenistic style, with the broken pediment with a central thallus, columns, friezes, figures, and more. Yet if the treasury was indeed designed to resemble the Greek-Roman style, then why didn't its creators, with their masons, also imitate the Roman carving method? Why choose a different and more difficult way to carve the columns, facade, and interior? Besides the tool marks, I want to bring up another point. Even though the treasury looks Hellenistic, its super Hellenistic details, such as the Corinthian-like column capitals and the intricate reliefs, might have been carved much later than the original structure. It's possible that initially the treasury's facade was similar to the monastery, another huge rocking wonder in Petra, with simpler columns and less adornment. It's obvious that these two majestic structures share a lot in common. If the original bottom column capitals of the treasury were the same as the ones at the monastery, then such capitals would have provided enough material for a later reshaping. Also, we see the unaligned beam holes on both sides of the treasury, but we don't see them at the monastery. These holes might be evidence of a Roman-era scaffolding when masons were commissioned to make the treasury's exterior look more Greek or Roman. The Roman-era masons appreciated the existing exquisite parallel tool marks and left them alone. Another intriguing thing I found is that the palace tomb exterior appears to be painted to represent a Hellenistic architectural detail, the dentils. Dentils are these small rectangular blocks used as decoration under the soffit of a cornice in ancient Greek and Roman buildings. Its precursor might come from when the Greeks were building with wood. This could be another piece of evidence that argues in favor of the stone-cut cave facades in Petra having been modified one by one to be more ornate and Hellenistic. Being the first monument seen at the end of the winding Sid Canyon, the entryway to the Petra city, it's conceivable the treasury was the primary building to be reworked on, while the even larger monastery is far from the city center and located on a high altitude, thus able to preserve its authentic Petra style. I heard that some caves in Petra have very smooth stone surfaces with no marks at all.
From photos, it seemed that the urn tomb's facade is quite smooth.
I would love to see some close-up photos. So, in summary, the treasury's main structure, its columns, pediments, and all areas that were covered with highly uniformed carving marks are likely the original stonework, predating the Greek-Roman influence. The treasury's Hellenistic details, such as the Corinthian-like column capitals, the dentils, and reliefs, were probably carved later by Roman-era masons with chisels, revealing a visibly cruder finish and masonry work. The tightly aligned markings are seen at the treasury, the urn tomb, and some other caves. Their existences indicate that the creators of Petra might have had advanced stone carving techniques that are more superior to hand-tool chiseling. Machinery like today's continuous miners, other hot rock excavators, and even 3D stone carving robots might have been utilized in creating these caves with huge interiors and beautiful facades with precise details and finishing. There were no such technologies 2,000 years ago, and Petra is an ancient and heavily eroded site. Therefore, I propose the real possibility that the treasury, along with other large-scale caves in Petra, might have been the work of a prehistoric, advanced civilization which have access to technologies on par with today's modern world. A final question. Even without the ornamental carvings, the main architectural form of the treasury still resembles the Hellenistic style. But if Petra's rocking structures were created by an earlier, advanced civilization, which predated the Greeks and Romans, that means Petra's style came before the Hellenistic one. What if the monuments in Petra were not influenced by the Hellenistic style, but it's the other way around, that the Hellenistic style imitated Petra's architectures? What do you think? If you have any insights, please leave a comment. If you like my video, please give a thumbs up and subscribe. Don't forget to hit the bell button so you'll be notified when I upload new videos. If you want to support me, my Patreon link is below. I have a wide range of topics that I want to share with you. This is Curious Being, I'm Tina. Thanks for watching and see you next time.